Well, as usual on a Sunday, we hear three readings, and perhaps this Sunday's are especially difficult, or at least the first one. It borders on the incomprehensible, I think. And yet, if we dig into them, there is a common thread between all three of them, and they are all about different contexts going forth. In the second reading, we have Abraham and Sarah going forth on the basis of God's promise, God's call to the promised land. And in that rather, as I say, mysterious first reading, it is actually talking about the Exodus. So this is a few centuries later from the time of Abraham, jumping from Abraham to the time of Moses, the descendants of Abraham and Sarah, who have become enslaved in Egypt, are now going to go forth in the night of the Passover and cross the Red Sea, journey through the desert, and come to that same promised land. And then in the Gospel, we have our Lord readying his disciples, that's us, we hope, for his return, telling them to have their loins girt, as the older translation has it, and their lamps burning, ready for their returning master. So there's this common thread of going forth, Abraham going forth, called out by God's word to go to journey towards the promised land. Then the people of Israel called to follow Moses out of Egypt towards that same promised land, and us being ready to be called out when the Lord comes to enter the kingdom of heaven. So it's a great reminder to us that as believers, we are people on a journey. We are travelers, we are pilgrims, and we need to be ready to leave things behind. In a way, all our life, it's a beautiful way to read our life, is to think of ourselves as being called different points in our life to go forth into leaving something behind, going forth into some new situation, the Lord leading us on step by step until the final call when we are called to see him face to face. I remember there's a monk at Pascoden who belonged to another monastery and transferred to our community. It was after he'd been in this other community for many, many years, over 30 years. It was a big change, a big disruption. Each community is distinctive, and he had to leave for certain reasons, had to leave his community, and he joined ours. It wasn't an easy passage, but he was a humble man, and thanks to his humility, he made it. But I remember another monk saying to him, well, it's a preparation, isn't it, for the final journey. Every Passover we have to make in our life is a preparation for the final Passover, when we are called to go from this world to the Father. When St. John Paul II was dying, he said, I'm going to the house of the Father. That's where we are called to. The poet Wordsworth famously said, great line, I think, half a line, the world is too much with us. The world is too much with us. It is, you know. I think it's such, our life nowadays is so complex, so ultra-organized, so bureaucratic. You know, if you've got a car, well, you've got to register it, you've got to tax it, you've got to insure it, you've got to service it, you've got to MOT it. That's just one thing in our life, a car, which is just the means of getting to A to B. You know, there's mortgages, there's insurance, there's paying taxes, all of these things are nightmarishly complicated at times. We even have to ask other people to do it for us. And then there's our families, and our work and all these things absorb us, really, and they dominate our horizon. Now, usually they're good things, and these are the things through which, by which, we go to God. But we mustn't forget the going to God bit. They mustn't become, as it were, the end, the final station. There is something beyond. They are part of the way. We are on the way to God. Nothing else will satisfy our hearts. Our hearts are restless until they rest in God. And so always we need this further horizon beyond all the particular things, necessities, duties, calls, the demands of other people, looking after ourselves even, all of these things, they do absorb us, but they're not ultimate, they are penultimate. There is something beyond. Perhaps it's a great weakness in our Christianity at this moment in history. Our great weakness is forgetting this further horizon. Even our Christianity, we focus so much on what we should be doing now, which is okay, true and fair and right, but it's all in view of something beyond, something still to come. It has been said, pardon a long word, that we suffer from eschatological amnesia, which means forgetting the last things, as we call them, death, judgment, heaven and hell, the resurrection of the flesh and life everlasting. So, perhaps this is the message for today, to try and travel light, to try and keep ourselves light as possible and allow our faith to point us always towards its fulfillment in vision. Now in the Gospel, just like to end with this, in the Gospel, our Lord talks about his return, and he gives two images that are very different. One is of the master of the household coming back from a wedding. We are the servants. We're the employees, as it were. We're in the house of the Lord, and we have our job to do, and we must wait for the Lord. We must keep awake, our loins girt, our lamps burning, waiting for him to return from the wedding feast. Now, the master, in this image, has gone away to get married, so he will be coming back at some time during the night with his bride, with an escort, with torches, with music, and everything. We'll hear him coming. We'll hear him coming. And we must be awake for that. That's one picture of, as it were, the return of the Lord, the parousia, as we call it, his second coming. But then, at the end, there's this other one. You may be quite sure of this, that if the householder had known at what hour the burglar would come. So, now, Jesus had a sense of humor. And Jesus calls himself a burglar, a thief. This isn't someone who's going to come with a fanfare, with a crowd. In those days, if you wanted to burgle a house, you had to dig under the foundation. So if you're in the house and asleep, and you just hear this little scratching, and you think, oh, well, it's probably a rat or a mouse or something. But no, it's actually a burglar trying to get in underneath, unexpectedly. And our Lord compares himself to a burglar or a thief. It's quite a surprising image. But the New Testament is full of it. We find that in the Gospels, we find it in the letters of St. Paul, it's in the second letter of St. Peter, and it's in the book of the Apocalypse. I will come as a thief. I will come as a thief. So he comes actually to steal. Now what is he going to steal? He wants to steal us. That's what it is. He wants to come into our life, steal us, and take us away to God the Father, to the kingdom of heaven. He's a good thief, but he's still a thief. Interesting thing, St. Therese of Lisieux, the little flower, she had a very difficult death. She died of tuberculosis, terribly painful death. But again and again, it's been pointed out in her last sayings and writings, she talked again and again about Jesus as the thief who is going to come and steal her away. And even though she was in great spiritual and physical pain, she even wrote a little ditty, and it doesn't, you know, you have to change it a bit into English, but it's as though she said, "The thief will come, ha ha, and steal me away, ha ha, alleluia, ha ha." So she was looking forward to the coming of this thief. Now, you know, I've never been a burglar, actually. I don't know how many of you have, but I'm, of course, I suppose a burglar's dream is when you come into the house, what you're after, the valuables, will be easily accessible. You know, they won't all be in a safe that is bolted down onto the floor or to the wall, that, you know, all the credit cards will all be lying around and the computer will be disconnected and the jewels will just be in a drawer and nothing there, so you can just help yourself. Well, perhaps that's what the Lord looks for in us, that we are not too connected, we're not over-involved in our lives. However seriously we must take all these things, it's true, but there must always be an inner freedom, so that we are ready to be snatched away by Christ. Snatched away. So let us keep ourselves simple, light, not over-absorbed in the things of the world. Our lamps burn, our faith alive, waiting for the Lord. St. Therese said, her sister said to her, "Well, you know, the thief is coming. Are you worried about this?" And she said, how can I have fear of the thief coming whom I love so much?